Okay. So we didn't even do that. Okay, let's try it again. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. My name is Quinn Jacobson, and this is the Studio Q Show Live. Whether you're watching it now and you're in here with us or you watch it later, it doesn't matter. You're going to get some good stuff today, I hope. We'll try to get all the questions answered. And I know you can't hear me. You couldn't hear me, but now you can. I muted myself. I was on the phone for a few minutes. So we're going to do a great show today, though. You're going to have a little bit of insight both in the technical side of this wet collodion process and also a little bit of conceptual stuff. We got some great things to share here from people, both email, some friends, that kind of stuff. So let's go ahead and get started with this thing like we do. Let's make sure all of our audio is good. Let me just pull this up on another screen and we'll start our little slideshow here. I hope everybody's doing well. Life is good up here. Slowly making progress on everything as we move along. And yeah, life is good. I hope everybody's enjoying it as well too. And here we go. So this week we're going to do a little bit of break it out into some technical stuff right off the bat. We're going to talk about contrast, what contrast is. One of the reasons I kind of pick these topics is through the week I'll get email and images sent to me, what's wrong. And most of it really revolves around proper contrast, tonal range, right? Proper good quality imagery. And so I just kind of pick them as we go, and we're going to talk about that, how to get good contrast, also known as what is contrast, right? Describe what contrast is. And then along the same lines, we're going to talk about making how to maximize or how to get the most out of a negative for pop printing. And I'm not talking about, and I'll describe this in detail, I'm not talking about bright ambrotypes, printing on modern developing out paper, those kinds of things. We'll go into it. Email this week, we'll talk a couple of issues email-wise we'll review. And then I ended up putting recommended reading and recommended watching. I'm going to add that. And shout-outs. One of my friends, Lisa Grant, posted a great Ira Glass audio piece on storytelling, which is so relevant to what we go through as photographers and artists and how to kind of see the big picture of what you're doing. And I think you guys will enjoy this stuff. I hope you do. So let's start with this. And you can chime in. I'm going to try to watch the chat. I don't know if I can completely. Hey, I appreciate that. Thank you. Yes, it is my birthday today. That's true. I appreciate all the warm birthday wishes and everything. I'm 35 years old. I don't look a day over 26. And life is good. No, I appreciate it. Thank you. Cheers. I appreciate it. However, it's 10 o'clock in the morning here, so I'm drinking bubbly water. I've already had all my coffee. Hello, Carlos from Galicia, Northwest Spain. Beautiful, wonderful. Thank you for joining us. And Mark, thank you very much. I appreciate that very much, Mark. Thank you. And Facebook user. Yeah, I knew people are going to start bringing up my birthday. I'm not here for my birthday, but I appreciate that. I do. I appreciate the birthday wishes. You get a certain age and it doesn't really matter much, right? All right. Thank you, Jeffrey. I appreciate that. So let's go ahead. Let's talk about what contrast is, actually. A lot of folks don't understand in detail what contrast is and what it means. So sometimes we talk about tonal range, Sometimes we talk about density, but you know, the whole thing is wrapped up around this idea of contrast, contrasting, putting something against something else, right? So in this case, when we talk about traditional black and white or color photography, film, digital, whatever, we're talking about, in our case, we're talking about the scale difference between the black and the white in the image. And a lot of times when you mess, when you don't get this right, the image does not work regardless of the content, regardless of your chemistry. Well, we'll talk about all this, but if you don't get this right, the image doesn't work, period. It's got to be, you know, visually compelling. Sometimes, you know, you can mess with this as long as you're in control and you know what you want to do, you can make it happen. There's a great one. Let me put this one up. I have a step, wedge, and densitometer for calibrating my film negatives. Do you recommend using similar process for collodion? Happy birthday. Thank you, Facebook user. I don't know what your name is, but thank you for that. Yes. If you have my book or you have access to my new videos, I go through using a densitometer for negatives in there. You can watch the D-max and D-min for wet collodion negatives and the particular pop printing process I'm using, whether it's aristotypes, collodion chloride, or albumin, or salt. Density and types of prints you want to make definitely marry up. You have to look at that. If you do it a while with wet collodion negatives, after a while with some experience, you can kind of hold them up, look at them with transmitted light, and you can kind of tell roughly what the density is. The D-max, meaning the maximum density, the brightest, the most light, the most silver on the plate. You put your densitometer on, it shoots light through and it gives you a reading. So for albumin prints, my little densitometer will read 1.95 to 2.2, really high, dense, really thick silver, a lot of silver on that plate in the highlights. And then the D-min, where it's not completely void, but the least amount of silver you have on the plate while still having silver on the plate, the D-min is the minimum on the plate. So you look at, you're most concerned with the D-max, the maximum density. That's where you want to check that density. 2.0 and over, really good for the really hard pot prints like salt and albumin. They're really, really big for that density. So great question. The answer is yes, and thank you for that birthday wish. I appreciate it. Emily, happy birthday to you. 35 indeed, me too. I know. Age is just a thing, right? It's just a number. We're all in this death denial thing, right? Every year you get older, the less you want to pay attention to that, because every year you get older, the closer to pushing daisies or having what we call a dirt nap, the closer you are to that. So you have to face those realities of getting older, which I love. I love my 40s. I love my 50s. I'm 57 today, so I'm not that old. I mean, come on, you know, but I appreciate that. That's funny, Malik. Thank you, Paul. So let's go back. Contrast this scale between the whites and the white and the black in your image. Really, really critical to nail this, especially in collodion, because you really The positives, you make tintypes or ambrotypes, and you're off just a little bit on this. You don't exploit that tone range. I talk about this a lot. I've talked a lot about this on this particular show, about people overexposing their positives and losing that beautiful tonal range. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about too much light or not enough light. And mostly in wet collodion, if you're a new user, a beginner, or just started this in, you know, last year or two or whatever, a lot of times you have a tendency to overexpose the image. It's really common because you read about how slow the ISO is in collodion, so you really give it the gun and you overexpose the image. You lose that tonal range. You lose that contrast and you're not exploiting the process for what it can do. So really important. So there's the definition. So let's talk about, how do we control contrast? What are some of the ways in the wet collodion process that we can actually control contrast or tonal range? I'm going to give you three areas that you can focus on, no pun intended, three areas that you can concentrate on. The first and foremost is absolutely exposure. This is what I see more than anything people having problems with. They just cannot quite get their, they can't quite get or understand until they see somebody that actually has an image that has great exposure on, they can't quite understand what we're talking about when we talk about exposure. So here's the key to that. You know you have a good exposure, and you know you have you're going to achieve the tonal range or the contrast you want with a good exposure by this definition. This is how I define it. So this is the first area to deal with. Overexposure is the most common problem for new photographers or wet collodion artists or photographers coming into the process. Positives require a lot of attention in this way. Exposure is the number one way to control contrast. Number one, without doubt. So a quarter of a stop can affect the contrast. Example, let's say a perfect exposure for the wet collodion positive is 10 seconds. So one stop difference, if we're reducing it down, would be 5 seconds. A half a stop would be 2.5. A quarter stop is 1.25 seconds. And I've shown this in workshops. I've literally shown 1 second difference on the exact same plate increases contrast and tonal range immensely. 1 second. That's all it is. 1 second. So when you start talking about being a second or two off, a little overexposed or a little underexposed, it's going to produce the same thing. But we mostly see this with overexposure. You're not going to have that full tonal range. You just won't. So exposure, number one. And how do we identify this? We talk about, let me go back here. I get back to my slideshow here. We talk about the way to control this is having the highlights appear in 3 to 4 seconds. And this is where you're going to find, it's going to vary a little with temperature, but having your highlights, you pour your developer and have your highlights appear in 3 to 4 seconds, your midtones in 7 to 8 seconds, and then your shadow or your void areas. Remember, the Alfred brothers talked about drapery. you start to see the drapery in the void areas. What he's talking about there is whatever's closest to the void area starts defining that void area. You should see that in about 12 to 15 seconds. You can add a few seconds if it's cold, 5, 8 seconds. You really don't want to go over 20 seconds. If you're going over 20 seconds, there's something off. So just keep that in mind. So that's how you tell with exposure, basically. The next is chemistry. So you need to understand how the chemistry works, each component of it, the collodion, the silver bath, and the developer in this case. And if any of those are off, it's going to affect your contrast or tonal range for sure. In other words, knowing what your pH and your specific gravity is in your silver bath, knowing how iodized, how highly iodized or not iodized very much your collodion is, really, really important in how that marries with your silver bath. And then in your developer, how much iron do you have, how much reducer do you have, and how much restrainer, iron and acid. Those are the things that you've got to concentrate on in chemistry, exposure, then chemistry. And this also applies to toning and fixing for prints too. So that exposure, all that stuff applies regardless. So controlling that contrast through exposure, then having your chemistry right, and then obviously developing. So like I say here, I can't emphasize how important it is not to overdevelop or underdevelop the image. It's critical that you stay within 15 to 20 seconds exposure for development. Adjust your exposure, never your development time. Don't say, well, this plate is 30 seconds and this plate is 10 seconds and this plate is a minute. Never do that. At least if you want to gain control of this process, you need to have some baseline standard. And that 15, roughly 15 to 20 seconds, depending on temperature, is where you want to stay, and you want to adjust the exposure. Pour another plate, try it again. If you're over, you're under, whatever you are. So if you have, if you're just starting out and you go outside and you load up a plate, pour a plate, load it up in your holder, pop your cap off or open your shutter up, and you say, oh, I don't know, let's try 5 seconds. And you do a five second exposure. You bring the plate back into the dark room and you pour your developer on, and that image flashes right up. It just woof, and sometimes it'll flash up and then kind of die back down and go away. That is complete overexposure, right? Flashes up right away. You pour your developer on, boom, there it is. And then sometimes it dies out. That's way overexposure, way overexposed. If you, on the other hand, if you pour the developer on and you sit there and you start counting, one, two, and you get up to 5 or 8 or 10 seconds, you know you're way underexposed. So let's say at 10 seconds, you just start seeing a highlight of something you saw in the image. You know you're way underexposed. Those are some of the, if you start that extreme, those are some of the indicators that you're either over or underexposed and you need to adjust that time. So don't ever try to control it through development that way. So do we have anything on the positive contrast? Those are the three areas: exposure, chemistry, and exposure, chemistry, and developing. Sorry. Those are the three things. Control it through the amount of exposure. And when I say chemistry here, the chemistry has to be right. In other words, you have to have the right amount of silver in your silver bath, the right pH, the right reducer and restrainer in your developer. Those are the two most important things. And then obviously we just talked about the exposure. So those are the three things you can control contrast with. Really important. If you start playing with this, taking good notes, you're going to find everything I say here is absolutely spot on, dead to the bone truth. So let's talk about the anything on the positive. Sorry, let me look at the chat. I'm getting, hey Renzo, good to see you. Thank you, Thilo. Thank you very much. Thank you, whoever the Facebook person is. They don't give names up here. So, okay. So sounds like you are saying definitely no zone system for wet plate. Just get it right in the first place. That's a good comment. Great comment. Basically, you could say yes. What I'm saying is we need to find this perfect balance. And I always talk about this when I'm chatting with somebody, or when we used to be able to chat with people live in person. I always tell people this. You need to understand both in your head and your heart, right? This is kind of an emotional thing too. It's not just technical. There's some intuitiveness. You got to feel this stuff going on. You get in the flow. Remember the book, Mr. C's book last week? You get in the flow, you get in the zone. So there's a little bit of that, but then you've got to know your chemistry. You've got to know your light, and you got to know your optic. In other words, your lens. So if you put all those three things together, and then just what we just talked about a minute ago about these other three, exposure, chemistry, and developing, if you put those together and you start working the system from that angle, believe me, your images will improve immensely, positive or negative. It doesn't matter. This applies across the board. We're going to talk about negatives next, but I have to admit, I rarely see well-exposed positives online. Rarely see them. They're either overexposed or just enough overexposure to knock that detail out, to knock that, you know, ambrotypes and tintypes should show almost this three-dimensional quality. Prints from negatives definitely should show that. But positives and tintypes should show this beautiful three-dimensional, and that's what we're talking about. We're talking about tonal range and contrast here. We're talking about defining that. If it's well lit and you've got the exposure right, your chemistry right, and your development right, and you know your light, you know your chemistry, and you know your optics, your lens, you pull all those things together, man, you're going to have a beautiful image. And once you recognize how gorgeous those positives, ambrotypes and tintypes can actually be, if you've never seen a really good one in real life, your mind will be completely blown away. Because what you don't know, you don't know, right? We're all in that boat. So if you're overexposing images, and there's something on the plate and it looks okay, you don't have any baseline to compare that with, you don't know where you're at. So take some of these ideas, take good notes, and start practicing this if this is something you need to work on, because you're really going to find a big, big difference once you start employing or using some of these ideas. Yes, so we did that one. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for all those kind wishes. I appreciate that. Let me just make sure I didn't miss anything back here. Good, 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 good. Okay, so now we've gone from, Pablo. What about dev time if using diluted developers, say 1:1 or 1:2 to get a wider tonal range? That's going to give you, how do I say this? That's going to allow you time to see what's happening. So a lot of times people say, oh my God, 15 seconds, I can't, what are you looking at? What are you seeing? You know, their eyes aren't used to the red light in the dark room. They've never done this technique before. They're concentrating on other things. So to tell them to say, okay, you got to watch those highlights. Where are they? 3 or 4, where's the midtones? And I always tell in workshops, when we set the camera up and we're looking at the ground glass, I point out on the ground glass, I said, look, let's look at your highlights here. Where's the brightest point? Oh, it's the earring on her. Okay, or the necklace or the shirt or whatever, this side of the face, whatever it is. Where's your brightest point? Burn that into your mind before you get into the dark room. Burn that into your mind on the ground glass. That way, when you pour that developer out, all you're concentrating on is to cover the plate effectively, catch a little bit of that, pour it back on. Then you start counting. So you want to see that burnt image in your mind on your ground glass, the highest, brightest point. You want to see that appear in 3, 4, 5 seconds. If you have that, you're on your way to having a good exposure. So Pablo, if you need more time, do that. Dilute your developer down. You don't run the risk of veiling or fogging or developing the unexposed silver. When people overdevelop, they develop the unexposed silver. That's the veiling that we'll wipe off with a cotton ball. We talked about this last week with the Alfred brothers. There's different ways to approach those vernacular, those words. But really what it is, when you overdevelop, when your developer is really hot and strong and you're not used to doing this and you're in that 15-second window, you can easily start to develop all that free silver on the plate, right? You overdevelop. So what Pablo is asking, if you cut that developer back with distilled water, can you take some more time and see that? Yes, you can. That's exactly what you can do. Yes. It takes a little, you have to be more patient and understand what you've done there. If you're restraining that developer, you're holding it back by diluting it. It's like adding a bunch of acid. It's kind of like how we make negatives, right? We go for a minute and a half. And those are all visual inspections on negatives. So yes, that's a great question and a very good point. And you can definitely do that. So Cedric, thank you very much. Merci beaucoup. I appreciate that. So we have now, we've gone from positives. Now we're going to work into some negatives. Let me see here what we need to do. I can put some more folks up here. Hold on. I don't like to. People come in and they want to see the whole show. So I'm going to try to get them in here. You know, this is the, we're on StreamYard here. And this is StreamYard. If you're listening, man, you've got to make sure we can get down here to these other folks down at the bottom to add them to the feed. There we go. Hey, Lisa, good to see you. Excellent. Hello. Yeah, we're going to see Lisa here in a little bit. We're going to use her Ira glass piece. So let's talk about negatives. We go from positives to negatives, and these negatives now have moved in to the realm of not only do you need good contrast, you also need density. And building density is really important, because if you don't have that density built, you're not going to make traditional pop prints or printing out paper prints. So let's talk real briefly what those are. Back in the old school days in the 19th and early 20th century, we had paper that required contact printing, and there were silver chloride prints that required a massive amount of UV, and there's no chemicals to develop them. The light energy produces the image on that paper or glass, whatever you're doing, right? Whatever substrate, and you then wash and fix the print. So there's no chemistry in developing that. So when we introduced the bromides and different things into the modern developing out paper, silver gelatin paper, times increased enormously. I mean, they went through the roof. So you could go from, you know, a 10-minute exposure on a pop print to a 20-second exposure under an enlarger, you know, going from the sun to the enlarger. So those are the difference. We're not talking about silver gelatin prints. We're talking about printing out processes or printing out paper, the old silver chloride stuff. So we have to address what kind of negative, what kind of wet collodion or any negative, for example, but what kind of wet collodion negative in this case do we need density wise to make those prints beautiful, tonal range, contrast, all the things we're talking about. And it gets very difficult to guess the proper exposure for a negative and take that negative out of the camera, develop it, and then lay it on a piece of paper and print it. Yes, you can do that. It's called a foundation negative. It's called a foundation negative where you make an exposure in your camera, take the plate out, develop it as normal, and you say there's enough density there to print on pop paper. Good luck. If you can do that, much better than I am. Much, much better than I am. Because 9 times out of 10, you're outside. You're chasing light. You're chasing different kinds of things that you're concentrating on. So what I do is I crawl up to the exposure I think it should be and make that exposure. I process that negative in the field. I keep it wet, and then I come back to the studio and I redevelop it to build density. Probably if I make 10 negatives, 8 or 9 of those are going to be redeveloped, even slightly. I've hit a few where they wouldn't even need any, but I'll do what's just called a one cup. I just kind of stiffen it up, brighten it up with pyrogallic acid, citric acid, and some water. We'll talk about that. So my thing is, you know, you don't always have to redevelop a negative, but a lot of times it's going to give enough that punch to get you past the hurdle of making pop prints. Now, a lot of people will say, Quinn, why don't you just open that lens up and let her fly? You know, give it a couple of minutes out in the sun. What will happen? Well, ironically enough, when you're making negatives in this particular process, a tiny bit of overexposure flattens that image, reduces the contrast, takes the density out, however you want to put it, slightly over. That's why I come up under it and then redevelop to it. When I redevelop, I'm adding 3 or 4 or 2 or 10 seconds to it, whatever it is that needs it, but I'm doing that visually and I can stop it anytime I want rather than guessing at what that exposure should be in the field. So do you always have to redevelop negatives in wet collodion? No, you don't. You can take a foundation negative if you nail the exposure and you can make pop prints. That's going to be the rare case. Most of the time you're gonna want to do a little bit of redevelopment at least, and sometimes a lot depending on the image, depending on what you're after. So having said that, we can take a look now at the next slide here, if I can get over there. And let's talk about what building density actually is. Now, this is from my book, Chemical Pictures. And I'm going to go through this briefly. If you guys are, some of you are out there saying, oh my God, what is this guy on? This is just crazy. I don't understand what he's talking about. When you work in wet collodion for a while, you're going to mostly be working in ambrotypes and tintypes. And after a year or two or 10, whatever your personal style is or whatever your learning capabilities are and how you personal learning theory, after at some point, after a while, you're going to say, hey, I want to make negatives and prints, or you're going to kind of grow past that positive phase, if you will, and you're going to want to explore negatives and prints. And in the 19th century, you weren't really called a photographer if you made positive, direct positives, ambrotypes and tintypes. You were called an ambrotypist or a tintypist. You were called a photographer in the 19th century when you made negatives and prints. That's what the definition of a photographer of the 19th century was. Ambrotypists and tintypists were kind of looked at, you know, kind of the diet, you know, a nickel a piece, and you kind of itinerant photographers that traveled around and made images. Like you see a lot of these pop-up tintype booths and stuff today, similar to that. Cheap, fast, inexpensive, fast, on the spot. There's no printing and preparing paper and toning and all that, right, with the negatives or the positives. So the negatives are a lot more involved, and that's why they kind of defined it that way, that you kind of have to have something on the ball chemically and in the process to understand how to do the negatives properly. So you've made your negative, or you've attempted to make a negative, and you hold it up with transmitted light and you look at it and you know it's not dense enough at all, and you want to make a salt print or an albumen print or whatever print, carbon print, whatever. So you want to add a little density to that. This recipe, it's called an iodine redevelopment. That's what I call it. And I'm just going to go through this real quick. Part A is an iodine. I call it rehalogenation. What happens when you take iodine and you pour it on silver? What is that chemical response to that? You know, the chemical response to that is that you start forming a very slightly, very weak, but very slight, a very slight, very weak. You start forming a layer of silver iodide, right? That's called that's what I call it. It's rehalogenating the plate, making it silver iodide sensitive again, silver bromide, silver iodide. So that iodine kind of opens that up to receive both light and other chemicals, which we're going to talk about here. So I rehalogenate the plate with iodine, make it kind of that silver that's on the plate, make it sensitive to light again. I do actually expose it to a little bit of light. And then I come back in and I take pyrogallic acid and citric acid. And don't let pyrogallic acid fool you. It's not a restrainer. It's a stainer. It's a developer or stainer. The citric acid is actually the restrainer in this redevelopment process. So 4 grams to 6 grams of pyro, 8 grams of citric. And then you use a little bit of silver nitrate, 10 drops or so in a cup. And you start pouring that on, pushing it off, pouring it on, pushing it off. And if you have my book and videos, you can see me do that a billion times in there. And you can control that, how much more time you want to build, or how much staining or density you want to build on that negative. You pour it on, pour it off, pour it on, pour it off. And you'll see that solution, that redeveloper, change from a clear, you know, just distilled water and pyro and citric in it, from a clear solution to red or even dark brown. That's replacing the iodine on the plate. That's you're pulling the iodine out of the silver. So you can go from black to clear glass doing this, or you can just slightly build it up. You have complete control. That's what I love about this redevelopment process. There's another one called intensification. And again, sometimes these words in this vernacular gets twisted around. But intensification is usually a bromide, ammonium bromide and copper sulfate bleaching the negative. And then you push the plate into a pan of 12 or 15% silver nitrate. And it just, boom, it just builds that density right up. And you can do a mild version of that too. Great question. Hey, Quinn, what kind of shelf life do each of these solutions have once mixed? Pyro will oxidize, but the iodine solution will stay forever. I've used pyro. I make a liter at a time. Unless I'm really cranking negatives out, that will last for months, 6 months anyway, you know, and probably even longer. The fresher, just like anything in life, right? The fresher, the better kind of thing. So it's a great question though. So that's what I do. Now, Malit asks about using ferrous sulfate in place of pyrogallic acid. There's a lot of people that do not like to mess with pyrogallic acid. I get it. You know, you don't want to mess with KCN. You don't want to mess with ether. You don't want to mess with cadmium bromide. And you don't want to mess with pyrogallic acid. Perfectly fine. Substitute the pyro with ferrous sulfate. And you'll have very similar. It may take you longer. And you may not get quite as dense or stained image as it just may take you longer. Just be aware of that. Mio, yes. How long does I would say tight, you know, nicely secured, no oxygen, you know, keep the lid on, cool, dark place, like we always talk about chemistry. 6 months to 8 months, easily, probably even longer than that. There's Malik right there. Question about negative exposure. You say underexpose, but you need to expose long enough to get your shadow detail. Any advice? Yes, I'm not really talking. You're right. I am talking about underexposing the negative. And you say, how do you know what that is? You're out there and you don't even know. One of the things I forgot to say, and you should have this as standard practice. It should be given. You make a positive plate first. To judge your light, to judge your scene, you need a direct positive to judge what the negative might want. In Archer's old literature, he says 1.5 to 2 times of a good positive. So if a positive was 10 seconds, you might do 15 to 20 seconds exposure on a negative. That's just rough. That's just a ballpark. So if, let's take that, Malik, let's say my positive was 10 seconds, a good positive was 10 seconds, I might go 13 or 14 seconds, somewhere in there, just based off of that. Then I'll build that density up if I need to. What I don't want to do, if a positive, it looks good at 10 seconds in this particular scenario, I don't want to go 20 or 25 seconds. That's what I'm talking about, because it will just completely flatten your image. You guys have done this. I know you have. You've even done it with a lot of positives. They just lay flat. They're white. You see little outlines and stuff. It's just way overexposed, and you lose density. So that's what I mean by crawling up to that. Don't get too close to it because I don't want to go over. I'll do the rest of it chemically with the redevelopment. And, man, you can get some beautiful negatives, absolutely gorgeous negatives out of that. It's some practice, right? And what Lisa shared the other day online, I'm going to show it to you here in a minute. Ira Glass talks about in storytelling, it's a really powerful message for people trying to work out their artistic, creative, and let's be honest, just the drudgery, the day-to-day, trying to pound these things out and get them right. This, you know, one of the problems in my mind with the world today is people want everything just kind of handed to them, right? Just hand it to me, just give it to me, right? Anything good is not going to come that way. So there's some work to be made here. There's some work to be put in here, right? You're very welcome, Malit. I hope that makes sense. So let's go back. Let's those redevelopment. Now, I just kind of went over this. There's a big difference when it comes to printing a thin negative versus a dense negative. Bright ambrotypes may look dense enough to print on pop. And in fact, some will. I have bright glass ambrotypes that wouldn't make an albumin or salt print, but would make a decent collodion chloride or aristotype print, those kinds of things. And unlike modern develop out papers, or DOP as some people call them, like Ilford and Kodak silver gelatin papers, printing out processes require massive amounts of UV and quite dense negatives to print properly the correct amount of contrast and tonal range to get that proper amount of contrast and tonal range. So when you get down to it, to make a beautiful, well-exposed positive or negative, you need to concentrate on those values to get that contrast. And there, Yufus, if you're watching, there you are in a workshop way back in the day, back in Denver. Oh, we, you know, I don't know, this was 10, I don't know, 10 or 12, I don't know how long ago, many moons ago. This is Yufus. He's down in Mississippi. You probably see his stuff online, Yufus Ruth. Good guy. This is him with his, I think this was a salt print we made, or collodion chloride, probably a lot of them. But this is a lot easier to teach when I'm in a dark room with a person or studio making plates and looking at this. But you get the idea of controlling that contrast, controlling that density, controlling that tonal range are all kind of the same thing. They're kind of intermixed and mingled together. But any questions on that? We'll move along if there's not, but I'm happy to answer anything you might have. I know it may be a little bit extreme technically to talk about this, but go back, listen, or watch the video again, and you might pick it up as you implement it in your practices. Any technical questions this week? Anything, anybody, this is just open to anything you have, if you have anything. If not, that's fine too, as always. You can chime in anytime you like. Look at my graphics crew. Man, they killed it again, right? Remember last week with the burning house? Now we got this crazy chemical professor. Man, they're good. My hat's off to my crew. All right, email this week. Let's talk about Paul. You're in here, brother. He sent me an email. He's been really doing some great things, a little bit advanced, but really good. I think it's a really good way for people to learn how these different processes work and what they need to do to make them work and substitute. Look, we're all over the world here. There's people from all over the world, and we have 60 people in here, right? So there are people from all over the world in here watching this. So a lot of times you can't get ether in this country. You can't get this product in that country. You can't, whatever it is. So a lot of times what we're trying to do is we're trying to find workarounds. In this case, Paul is trying to find a workaround making asphalt and butter, batter or tintype batter, whatever you want to call it. And he either can't get Canada balsam or he wants to try other solutions in it. What are we talking about here? We're talking about this tint, what I call batter, tintype batter, gilsonite, asphaltum with mineral spirits, Canadian balsam, a tree sap, and boiling it up and making a blackening solution to either pour on metal and bake and make true ferrotypes or tintypes, or take your glass positives and pour on the front or the back of them, whatever you choose to do. We all know the archival thing is out there about that, pouring it on the collodion side. But he's trying to make that rich, black, shiny, sheeny batter to put on his positive images. And what he's trying to find is an alternative to the Canadian balsam. What is the balsam? What are we talking about here, guys? We're talking about a plasticizer in the batter. Just like varnish, you need something to keep the varnish or the asphaltum flexible so you don't get spider cracks in it. And you can see this first image, he's got cracks in that one. So what he's saying is, I'm experimenting with the alternative to the balsam and the asphaltum batter. The gum Damar, which is kind of like the old gum Sandarac back in the day, Damar they used. I made, tried, still became brittle and spider cracks appeared overnight. So he's dealing with not having the correct plasticizer and having the spider cracks show up in his asphaltum or on his plates. And then next he tried linseed oil, and you can see what he did there. And boiled is the recipe called. Definite improvements, but you can still see cracking and continues to crack further at day two. So there's two reasons this can happen, right? Now, if you put lavender oil in there, I bet you wouldn't see any cracking. You possibly, depending on how thin it is. I've had Canada balsam or the balsam, the sap itself, crack on me when I poured too thin. It's not a big deal. You just put some more on, it'll fill up. But if it's too thin or there's not the appropriate plasticizer, you're going to have these problems. And then he's got a really good looking one there on the right side. So he's made some progress. It's fun to see people work through this and try to help him out figuring that out. There's another part of his email. Look at this. This is what I really enjoy sharing. I've been Keeping my plate holders super clean too. Here are some of this week's results. Look at the before and after. I'm just keeping the edge of your plate holder clean. How many times do we hear this, right? How many times do you see a filthy plate with all kinds of stuff because they just don't clean the sides of their plate holder out? Really simple stuff. Really simple, but it's great to share those things. I appreciate that, Paul. Thank you for letting me share those images. So here's the question. When I use a hairdryer, I notice a dramatic change in the tone of the image. It goes from this silvery CP kind of tone to a deep silver, almost steel look. All my images, I've used a hairdryer, no comparison yet until last night, see below. Is it a consequence of heat drying or maybe fix? He's using a 20% or... Oh, he meant 200 grams of not ferrous, but sodium thiosulfate, I believe. So to answer your question, Paul, this it's called drying bright, and all wet collodion image will dry bright. And it's partially due to the size of the silver crystals and the water evaporating, and you're reflecting light from it. So you're going to have a bright image. It's drying bright, usually 1.5 to 2 stops brighter than when it's wet. And I say here, you always want to judge your exposure when the image is wet, because that's going to look very similar when you varnish it, right? So don't pay attention. You dry it down. Oh my God, it's silvery and shiny and bright. And oh my God, it's way overexposed. Then you varnish it and it'll pull it back down. You'll gain that contrast. Again, you'll gain that contrast and tonal range with the varnish. I'll tell you a quick little story. Back in the 19th century, a photographer would be working, making a portrait of someone, and he slightly underexposed it, right? Maybe the light changed, the cloud came over, whatever was happening. He slightly underexposed it, processed it anyway, dried bright, and the customer said, oh my God, that's perfect. Don't varnish it, because when you varnish an underexposed image, it darkens back down to that wet state. And it'll look a half a stop or a stop underexposed. So the customer would say, leave it. And they'd put a piece of whatever glass over it, if they could afford it, tape it up and try to seal it and not varnish it. And we've talked about this a million times. If you don't varnish your images, there's sulfides and pollution in the air. Silver sulfide is black. It will tarnish the silver on your plate. But that's basically drying bright. It happens to every image. But you want to judge your exposure when the image is in the wash. And that will, again, looks very similar to what they look like when they're varnished. And then another question, prior to the damaging the image myself, this is an image behind this slide. I did notice what looked like streaks in the area of George's hair, almost like a waterfall look when I was pouring the collodion, right? I noticed I had some very fine line streaks, ridges in the collodion as it started. Is this an issue of evaporated alcohol? Do I top this off, or is it lacking the rocking and drain? So there could be two things, okay? There are a couple of things. Number one, the rocking is very important to get the striations out of there. But I'm thinking if these are like chambered lines, or the way you describe them, it could be that you have a little too much water in your alcohol. And we have a tendency when we dissolve those salts down when we're making collodion to add a little too much water. We only need a tiny bit of water. The old literature says water is injurious to collodion. And what it does, it creates those chambered lines or those crepey lines or those waterfall lines, whatever you want to call them, right? So you can either cut back when you make collodion, cut back, use as little water as you can to dissolve those salts, and that stuff should go away. Great questions, though. I appreciate that. So let's check. Steve's okay. Yes. Let's see. Oh, wow. We have a bunch of them. Okay. Let's do this. Hey, Quinn, I took some outdoor shots this past week and they are almost like dags, very shiny, reflective and full of color at certain angles. What may cause this effect? The faint rainbows of colors dance over the place. That is a couple of things. Overexposure, probably a little bit, but if they're drying out, I'm assuming these are non-varnished images. And that iridescent color is usually in your fix. You can get what's called Prussian blue on the edges of your plate. If you're using KCN, that's... the fix hanging in there that you still had some iron developer on your plate, when you fixed it with KCN, that'll give it a kind of an iridescent sheen and sometimes blue edges. And they do. I've actually made some that do resemble daguerreotypes quite a bit. It's a great question. Look at your exposure. Look at your recipes in your developer. If you have a high pH or low pH silver bath, like you've added nitric acid to your silver bath, that'll increase coolness and silver images. And if you're using sodium thiosulfate, it will also knock out some of that warm tone that you get with KCN. It's a great question, though. How can I clean my tintypes? Do you mean like the surface of them? Use a cotton ball. You'd usually want to do this if you have veiling, unexposed silver that you've developed. You put them under water and use a cotton ball on them and clean that off. That should clean right off. Or do it when you're processing them. Also interestingly, the varnish did dissolve some of the image, made it lighter, but it did not take away the effect, honestly, and enhanced it. If your varnish is dissolving the image, it means that you're using older, highly iodized collodion, and that nitrocellulose is going to be really sensitive to the alcohol in your varnish, and it will literally melt the image. But yeah, I would have to see them, honestly, to try to help you answer that. But honestly, that's interesting. Okay. Yeah, people get all kinds of stuff. Hey, Steve, good to see you, brother. Hey, Q, can you talk about how sodium thio versus KCN affects the silver molecule? Yes, there are different sizes, right? You have different sizes and different stages of the silver. And the way it's reflected, the value or the color it gives, and we're talking positives here, right? And you have that spectral sensitivity and negatives too with KCN, but we're talking positives. So two things that will affect the color, more or less, are the minimum amount of developer you can use on the plate, so you retain a lot of that silver there, and using KCN. That'll usually give you a warmer red, yellow, those warm colors in the final image, which I like. I've said it a million times. One of my words, you know, memory, identity, difference, and justice, those four legs that hold my work up. One of them, memory, I like that color. That's why I don't want silvery or cool images. How could I obtain that? Use 10% sodium thiosulfate. It changes the way the light hits the crystal, a reflected light. It's cooler. It's not as warm. It reflects actually bigger. It reflects more light, right? And so those two fixes make the world of difference, both in color and sometimes even a little bit of tonal range and contrast, depending on, you know, I don't want to go down that too far, but it can affect that. So great question. Thank you for that, Steve. Jean, thank you for that. There's Paul. He said, hey, thanks, Quinn. That rings true as I use potassium-based solution. Had to add a little bit more when I made it to fully dilute it. Yeah, there you go. Thank you for adding that. That justifies my answer a little bit. No problem. Arriving late, it's better than not arriving at all. I appreciate that. And here's Dawn. Regarding rainbow-like colors on a plate, this effect can also be due to Newton rings, which is the physical cause of color oil spots in parking lights. Yes. And Dawn, you know what? I'll give you one even better. I used to take daguerreotype plates, right? Silver-coated copper, and I'd drop a little iodine crystal on it, and you can watch it form the different color rings out like that too. Yeah, you can get into all kinds of cool color stuff with this stuff. And again, I told you this last week, but this project I'm going to do up here in the mountains starting this year, I'm going to do color oil prints on glass. You just start getting, if it's applicable to your work, right, not just doing this randomly, unless you want to do it randomly, it doesn't really matter. But you can really get into some cool ideas about how to manipulate the chemistry to give a certain tone or color or muted stuff, a muted color, I would say, without actually adding color. One of them, like daguerreotypes, overexposure in the skies and the blue, same thing with wet collodion. You can get some of that stuff going on. Carlos, I can buy two kinds of ether, one stabilized with BHT and one stabilized with hydroquinone. Which would be better to mix with collodion? BHT. Get this BHT stabilizer. And keep in mind, alcohol is also an ether stabilizing compound for ether. Alcohol. So if you mix your alcohol and ether together when you get it, your ether stabilized, no peroxides. But Carlos, get the BHT. That's the one I would recommend. That makes sense. So that makes, I was making tintypes for a haunted tour and was asked to make them spooky. At first one, the last day, a heavy Prussian blue. There you go. I use the same fix for another four images, all the warm colors. Perfect. Thank you for that, Facebook user. I appreciate those comments. I tried to experiment with that some more, wasn't it? Yeah, do it. And if you do experiment with that, come on back, jump in StreamYard and share some images. People here wanna see the stuff. We all wanna see it, and we're definitely interested in your results. Yes, I have tried every varnish you can imagine and then some, all of them. So Damar, Sandirac, Shellac, Soluvar, Liquitex, all of them. And guess what I use? I use gum Sandirac. But that's just me personally. That doesn't mean you use it, right? You can use anything you want. Anything you'd like to use, you can use that way. I mean, within reason, right? So let's go to thank you for all those questions. That's just wonderful. We have a large group in here today. I love it. Let's go to my recommended reading. A lot of you know this book, I'm sure, but if you don't know this book, I try to give you quick reads, not these huge 800 page tomes, right? Quick reads. Art and Fear: Observations on the Perils and Rewards of Art Making. So I already had this book pulled up when I saw Lisa's post the other day with the next thing we're going to look at here. And these things go together so well. I couldn't help but share that and connect them together. This is Bales and Orlin, Explore the Way Art Gets Made, the reasons it often doesn't get made and the nature of the difficulties that cause so many artists to give up along the way. And this is these are my personal comments. I enjoyed it, although I didn't fully agree with everything in it. And, you know, you might not either. I think it's a very valuable read for every artist. I try to apply it in the sense of not finding excuses not to make work. It's always easy to say, oh, I don't know if that would really work, or I don't have time today. Oh, I didn't mix any chemistry up. Oh, it's hot outside. It's cold outside. It's whatever. They talk a lot about the reasons why we don't make art when we should be even making bad art, right? We should be working toward that. I love this first quote. You have to kind of, if English isn't your native language, it might be a little difficult. It's a little bit of an idiom, so to speak, but it says, it's easier to paint in the angel's feet to another's masterwork, than to discover where the angels live within yourself. You get that? You understand what they're saying there? In a nutshell, it's easy to copy or emulate someone's work rather than finding what that work is inside of you that you should be making. And that's what we all do. Influence is incessant. We have to fight it every day. We're influenced by everything all day long. So we have to fight and push back to keep our individual beliefs and compass right, right? Because we're so pressured from our societies that it's easy just to kind of fall into that. So what they're saying there, it's easy to emulate something or copy something. That's why, you know, the groves with the trees and the this and the that, all this kind of derivative work that's been made over and over and over again. You see it online all day, every day. It's easy to do that. What's difficult to do is reach down inside and have the chutzpah or have the gumption or the desire or the will or the, what's the word I'm looking? The courage. They use that a lot. The courage to put that work out there. It's something that's really personal to you. Something that's really important to you. And then the other quote is very true. Even talent is rarely indistinguishable over the long run from perseverance and lots of hard work. That's where we just don't want to put the work in a lot of times, right? I'm guilty of it. Jeffrey says, Are you making work? Chuck Close said it best. Some wait for inspiration, others just work. Yes. You know what else Chuck Close said? Thank you for sharing that, Jeffrey. You know what else Chuck Close said? Chuck Close said, what else did Chuck Close say? I just lost the quote in my head. Sorry. I'll come back to it if I remember. He said, photography is the most difficult medium to define oneself. In other words, everybody does photography. You're just another blade of grass out there. You're just another number. And this is, he said this pre-digital. So can you imagine what he'd say now? And if you don't know Chuck Close, check his work out. He's amazing. He did daguerreotypes. He's a painter primarily. Wonderful, huge, gigantic stuff. But expose yourself to these artists. Get to know what other, you know, explore sculpture and painting and performance art and all these things, because it will really help you as a photographer, and it'll really help you in the wet plate process. So anyway, I recommend that book this week. And I'm going to do a recommended watching. Has anybody here, this is my absolute favorite film of all time. There's no film better than this. There's not another film that's inspired me and my work like Gummo has. Harmony Korine is the maker of this film. He also did Julian Donkey Boy. He worked with Tulsa, the Oklahoma, I'm forgetting the names. I'm drawing blanks today. I've been too busy, I guess. But this is, who is that? Who's saying this is one of my favorites of all times? I got to know your name. I got to know who you are. Because if you know Gummo, you're on the same wavelength as me. This is what inspired my Portraits from Madison Avenue work. This was the biggest influence on me as far as artists art goes than anything else. Oh, Eric, good to see you, Eric. That does not surprise me. you can read over here this quote. But look what he says at the end. Photographer work, unvarnished mode with work by photographers like Nan Golden or Deanne Arbus. And those are two of my favorite photographers. I've actually met Nan Golden. She called me belligerent once I was pushing back on her commentary on Donna Ferrato's work. And, well, aren't you belligerent? But I still love her work. I don't care. But let me play this. It's like a 2-minute clip. And if you just kind of watch and observe the human, oh, thank you, Tulsa, Larry Clark. Thank you, Mark Zimmerman. I knew you'd get that. And Harmony Korine and Larry Clark did Kids. And I didn't care for that film, actually. I didn't care for it. Ah, Zine, Ohio, there you go. Oh, my God. Anyway, this is getting too insighty. So I'm going to play this, and you guys check it out.
My name is Terry. This is my brother, Felipe. Hi, man. Would you be interested in purchasing a crunch bar?
How much?
$1.
Okay.
The money goes for children with cancer. Also, it's for Hodgkin's disease. Thanks.
Okay. Have a nice day. Some dessert.
Making all this money. Yeah, all the hoes like this. Yeah. fire teachers too, so I wouldn't have to go to school no more. Tease people too. Yeah, make them my friend, and I tease them with the money. They'll be my friends more often also. Yeah, we can have all this. We can be rich. We'll be going around teasing women and stuff. Yeah, selling candy, getting money. Just selling candy, getting money, making the greenbacks.
I was all right for a while. I could smile for a while. But I saw you last night. You held my hand so tight. As you stopped to say hello. Oh, you wished me well. You couldn't tell.
So... that was Bunny Boy there at the end. But if you haven't seen the film, check it out. The Red Hot Chili Peppers said it was their favorite film, Flea, and lead singer. They were talking about it one day, and I looked it up. It was the year that it came out. I looked it up, and I just absolutely fell in love with that film. It will change the way you visually look at things, how film works, how humans behave. It just check it out. As an artist, I don't care what medium you work in, but if you're in photography, it's just amazing stuff. So that's my recommended watching for this week. So here's Lisa. And this goes back to the heart of the matter about perseverance, about art and fear, making work, persevering through it. So I want to play this. I thank you, Lisa, for posting that the other day. I appreciate that. I'm going to play it here and listen to what Ira Glass has to say.
Nobody tells people who are beginners, and I really wish somebody had told this to me, is that all of us who do creative work, like, you know, we get into it, and we get into it because we have good taste. But it's like there's a gap that for the first couple of years that you're making stuff, what you're making isn't so good, okay? It's not that great. It's trying to be good. It has ambition to be good, but it's not quite that good. But your taste, the thing that got you into the game, your taste is still killer. And your taste is good enough that you can tell that what you're making is kind of a disappointment to you. You know what I mean? A lot of people never get past that phase. A lot of people at that point, they quit. And the thing I would just like say to you with all my heart is that most everybody I know who does interesting creative work, they went through a phase of years where they had really good taste. They could tell what they were making wasn't as good as they wanted it to be. They knew it felt short. It didn't have this special thing that we wanted it to have. And the thing I would say to you is everybody goes through that. And for you to go through it, if you're going through it right now, if you're just getting out of that phase, you gotta know it's totally normal. And the most important possible thing you could do is do a lot of work. Do a huge volume of work. Put yourself on a deadline so that every week or every month, you know you're gonna finish one story. Because it's only by actually going through a volume of work that you're actually going to catch up and close that gap. And the work you're making will be as good as your ambitions. In my case, like I took longer to figure out how to do this than anybody I've ever met. It takes a while. It's going to take you a while. It's normal to take a while. And you just have to. Okay.
Very, very good. That is some of the best advice ever. that is great. There's nothing more to be said than when you hit walls or you're sitting there saying, I don't know, this is just crap. Nobody, you know, what am I doing? This is just, why should I even continue? Or what should I do? Right? A lot of times you're not even at that phase. You're like, what should I do? And you end up making something, and you make a couple of pieces. It's crap. Oh, I'm not gonna do this. I'm gonna quit. And that's where you never, like he's saying, you never get over that hurdle. And I'm not saying that I have arrived in any sense of the word. What I'm saying is that I fought through those battles. I fought through those battles on a couple of things in my life that I really enjoy doing and that I really have a passion for. And then I believe that it's very important for me to do. It puts meaning in my life and it gives me purpose, and to quit pushing through those can be really dangerous. So I wanted to share that with you. And thank you again, Lisa, for that. Anybody have any questions? Or we've done our little bit over our hour here. Oh, that movie isn't available, at least in Germany, anywhere. Oh, I'll try to find it for you. Just send me an email and I'll try to find it. Yeah, and Linda, good to see you. I'm totally in that phase right now. I can yes, and I think, you know, I think anything you do in life, you tend to go in and out. If you're not trying something new, or if you're not doing something that inspires you, and like he said, your taste is killer. You know what you want. You got that vision, right? How do you make that appear tangible, right? Yeah, I just love what he says. It's the work's a disappointment, man. I have made probably 1,000 plates that are just completely disappointing to me. So it's a very good, very good advice. Pablo, can you make it stream out of Streamio? I'm not sure what that is, Pablo. I don't know what that is. If you're talking about Gummo, I'll try to find that. It's old enough now. So, well, thank you, Jan from Norway, my friend. It was, I thought you guys might enjoy this. It's kind of a mixture between the technical and conceptual. When we leave the conceptual out of everything, I don't think we can grow. We can grow technically. You know, how many grams of that is in there? And how many do you know? And that's all great. That's wonderful. But at the end of the day, we can't really grow unless we talk about the conceptual. And it's hard to talk about the conceptual. Nobody wants to talk about that because it's difficult to talk about that. It's easy to talk about what kind of camera you have, what kind of lens you have, what kind of collodion you use, how many grams of potassium iodide you use. Those are really easy topics to talk about, but they're difficult topics to talk about when it comes to concept. What's the work you're making? Why are you making it? How are you making it? Let's see it, you know, those kinds of things. It's very, very difficult to get the images you want, Linda, totally. And if you're anything like me, honestly, it's never quite right. It's never quite there. I mean, I have never arrived in my mind. And Steve says, Q, not to be obvious, but do you have a place for donations to help? Oh, you know what, Steve? You bought my book, brother. I appreciate you saying that. I really don't. I just try to come on. I don't want this thing monetized. I don't want, if you want to help me out, if you want to do anything for me and you don't have my book, grab my book. I would greatly appreciate it. Thank you so much. Steve Wilson's a great guy. I've known him for years. Well, known him for years, you know, like we do online. Glad I joined. See you next week again. Happy birthday. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Hi, guys. I just tuned in the end of the session. Maybe next time I'll put a question about recycling chemistry. Do it, Luis. Do it. We'll answer those questions. And, Streamio. Okay, Pablo, I'll look into that. Henrik, thank you very much. Great talk. Thank you, Henrik. I appreciate that as well. Very interesting today. And deep diving chemicals, have so much to learn only doing my plate for 1 year. Linda, you're doing great. You're doing great. You just are. That was Craig. Oh, the conceptual discussions are to me key to growth. You are so right, Craig. You are so right. I think, you know, you can build your muscles, right? You're technical. You can build your muscles, and that's great. Physically, you want to be in physical. But if your mind's not working, you know, if you're not using that, the gray matter upstairs, and you're not critically thinking, and you're not self-examining, and you're saying, really, what is it that I'm doing? And really, not to be hard on yourself, it's not that. It's just to be able to self, like Socrates, right? Self-examination. That's what we're talking about. Muchas gracias por todo. I appreciate that. Thank you very much. So with that said, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for your hour and 14 minutes. You are gracious and kind, and I truly appreciate it. And please join me next week. We'll come up. I'm sure my email box will be full. We can come in. And Jeffrey, I hope you can show some work next week if you're ready. If not, no pressure. The last thing I want to do is have people get some, come on, bring some work in here so we can criticize it. No. When you're ready and you want to show some work, please let me know. And I love sharing work. Thank you, Paul, for sharing that. Thank you, Lisa, for letting me coming in here, and then for the Ira Glass piece. I like Ira. I've listened to Ira Glass for years, so it was just a great thing. Thank you, Thilo. Thank you, everyone. I appreciate your time and your participation. How does an hour go by so fast? Thank you, Steve. I'll see you guys next week. Be safe, be healthy, and enjoy life every day. Bye-bye. Ciao, ciao.